Today's topic for the discussion is refrigeration and air conditioning. Myself Sanjay Agarwal and with me Mr. Sasank Srivastava.
Hello.
Now I am going to explain the application of the refrigeration. First application is preserving the fresh food. Second is to store medicines, vaccines, blood plasmas, to store flowers to preserve. Ice plants use refrigeration machines. Industries use refrigeration for producing frozen fruit juice, ice creams, chemicals. Manufacturing industries use refrigeration. Refrigeration is used for chilling oil to remove wax in oil refineries. Now question arises, what is a refrigerant? The common refrigerants available at reasonable cost are ammonia, carbon dioxide and freon 12. Freon 12 condenses at moderate pressure and under normal atmospheric temperature conditions. This property makes the refrigerant suitable for most refrigeration application. Now I would like to request Mr. Sasank Srivastava to explain further.
As my colleague has already told, what are the basic uses or applications of refrigeration? So basically this is summer time, as we know, so a lot of refrigeration uses there, like we use in ACs, we use coolers, all these are refrigerants only, and this refrigerator is also there for preserving our vegetables and all. So these are the particular uses, and it is a very common term which is used and known by the layman also. So further moving ahead, what are the refrigerants? As told by my colleague Dr. Sanjay Agarwal, that there are certain kinds of refrigerants like freon 12 and ammonia and all those, carbon dioxide also. But these ammonia, carbon dioxide, they were used previously, but nowadays freon 22 and all these things are also used. But freon 22 is also going to be phased out, and by 2012 India had also made one target that it has to phase out that thing, because this causes ozone depletion, and we have further hydrocarbons which can be used as refrigerants, so that will be coming up soon.
So, Mr. Sasank, how will we explain the what is a refrigerant? The question arises in mind to the student. Just we have to explain in one or two line. So, how do you explain the refrigerant?
Actually, refrigerant is that substance which runs in the whole refrigerant cycle.
Okay.
And it is the one which is providing the cooling. Like in the evaporator, we have to cool the particular substance which is there, like we have vegetables in our refrigerator. Mm-hmm. So that has to be cooled, that has to be kept up to a certain temperature, so that it is preserved. So that heat is taken up by that particular refrigerant. That is the work of the refrigerant. Mm-hmm. What should be the desirable properties of the refrigerant? Like one property is it should have high latent heat of vaporization. Meaning latent heat of vaporization, first of all, what it is? It is the heat that has to be taken up by the substance to change its phase. Meaning if it is in the liquid phase, it will change to the vapor phase, and that heat taken up will be latent heat of vaporization. So if the refrigerant is having high latent heat of vaporization, then what will happen that it can extract more amount of heat from that particular substance which is to be cooled, and more cooling can be provided. Then it should be obviously non-toxic, and meaning no health hazard should be there, because otherwise if it leaks, then it can cause health hazard in case of refrigerators and all, because it is being used in common purposes. Then desirable saturation temperature should be there. Then chemical stability, meaning it should not decompose into dangerous substances, and it should not be non-flammable also, and non-explosive as well. Then there should be an easy method to detect the leak. Because in case of leak, we should be able to detect whether our refrigerant is leaking or not, otherwise the whole system can fail. Then it should be available at low cost, economy also comes in, and it should be readily available. And commonly used freon is R12 and R114.
Refrigerator we are using, which refrigerant are generally used in refrigerator?
Generally it is freon 22 only we are using in India, but I told that this thing will be phased out soon, so hydrocarbons will be coming up.
So why it is used? It is a reason behind this is cost or something else?
Basic is as it is very readily available, and cost is also one of the reasons. So basically we have two types of refrigeration, which is vapor absorption and vapor compression refrigeration. And the type of refrigerant that is determined by the required cooling temperature. As I have earlier told, that this cooling temperature, if it is having a high latent heat of vaporization, the particular refrigerant, then it can give more cooling effect. So that's why this refrigerant is determined by the required cooling temperature. Then various refrigerants that are being in use are like chlorinated fluorocarbon, CFCs, or freons like R11, R12, R22, all those. The choice of compressor, the design of the condenser and evaporator are determined by the refrigerant, the amount of cooling that is required, the load and the ease of maintenance, then how much space it has to occupy, then the availability of the utilities like water and power. And then we go on to the vapor absorption refrigeration. The vapor absorption refrigeration technique is one which doesn't use any mechanical rotary part. It uses the heat, like from steam it uses the heat, and using that heat the whole refrigeration cycle runs. So basic components of the absorber system are, the first of all is the absorber, then the evaporator, and then condenser and generator. So these are the basic components. I will discuss it further in detail in the later slides. Then one more very important aspect is for summers also, and for maintaining a comfortable temperature for the people in their houses and in various working places, that is air conditioning. And what is that? That is the process of conditioning the surrounding air according to the human comfort and desire, and that is the definition of air conditioning. Then what is the application? We know that, like I told you earlier, that restaurants, hotels, home, hospitals, everywhere it is being used. And it helps in controlling the moisture, that is humidity level. It's very important, because humidity is that factor which causes a certain degree of comfort for the persons who are there. And then in business and industries, air conditioning improves the efficiency. Then in manufacturing also, somewhere we have computer terminals also, then we have to put that refrigeration system, that air conditioning system. Because some equipments are there which can't sustain the temperature, high temperatures. So for that purpose also air conditioning is required. Then in pharmaceutical, chemical plants and food industries also it is very widely used. One air conditioning system diagram you can see on the screen. There you can see that the air is coming in, and through the dampers the air is being directed. And through the air filter, all the dust particles and many other things are being filtered out. Then it coolant is also coming in through the other portion where you can see, and then it is going out also in the drain that is collecting. Then further we have got the heating coil which maintains temperature accordingly, and that air and fan we have got which will further enhance the temperature and it will be supplied to the system. Then the advantages of the window air conditioner. Separate temperature control can be provided in each room in which the unit is installed in case of the window air conditioner. And then we don't require ducts. Obvious, it is very obvious that we don't require ducts for air distribution then. And the disadvantage is that it has got a fixed air quantity and the installation must be made only on the outside wall. Then we come to how does this refrigeration system works. So basically you can see the thing on the screen, that there is a high temperature reservoir and a low temperature reservoir, and in between there is a system that we can say it is a refrigeration system, or it is a heat pump or an heat engine. So what happens here, that in case of refrigerator, what we have to do, or in case of air conditioner, that we have to cool something, or we have to throw the heat from a colder body to a hotter body. So what we have to do then, because it's not a natural phenomena, heat generally flows from a high temperature body to a low temperature body. So what we have to do now, we have to pump this heat from a colder body to a hotter body, and for that we have to do work, and that work that is supplied will be through the compressor. AC conditioning, split air conditioners are also there, like I told, window air conditioners, and fan coil units are there in a larger system, and air handling units also in a larger system. Refrigeration systems for industrial process, like earlier I discussed, in the chemical industries and pharmaceutical industries also it is used. So we can see how many types of refrigeration systems are there. That is a small capacity modular units of direct expansion type are there, that is up to 50 tons of refrigeration. Then centralized chilled water plants with chilled water as a secondary coolant, that is 50 to 250 TR. And then brine plants with brines as lower temperature secondary coolant, that is more than 250 TR. Then What are the types of refrigeration systems that we have already discussed and it is coming in? That is vapor compression and vapor absorption. The vapor compression one uses mechanical energy, whereas the absorption one uses thermal energy. With the vapor compression refrigeration, what are the advantages? Lot of heat can be removed. So we lot of thermal energy to change liquid to vapor, because we have got the compressor here, so that can be done. Then heat transfer rate remains high. That is, temperature of the working fluid is much lower than what is being cooled. So it can take up the heat. Since the refrigerant is at much lower temperature than the substance which is being cooled, so it can take up heat. Capacity of the refrigerator. I have discussed the term TR, that is tons of refrigeration, so we can know about it here. It is the rate at which heat can be extracted from cold body and the rate at which refrigeration can be produced. And how it can be defined as? It can be defined as the quantity of heat removed or refrigerating effect to freeze 1 ton of water at 0 degree centigrade to ice at 0 degree centigrade in 24 hours. So that will be 1 ton. And how it is calculated? That is equivalent to 3.5 kilojoules per second. If we calculate, we will get that amount. That means it is 3.5 kilowatt. So all this thing is that we have to freeze water, and that water is at 0 degree centigrade. It goes to ice at 0 degree centigrade, and in the whole day, how much of it is formed, that will define our TR. Then very important term comes up, that is COP. What is a COP? So COP is coefficient of performance of a refrigeration system, and it is actually the ratio of heat that is extracted in a given time to the work input to the system. Like we are doing some work, I have told earlier that we have to do some work to push heat from a colder body to a hotter body. So that is the work done, and then due to this work some heat will be extracted and the body will be at a cooler temperature. So that will be the heat extracted. So the ratio of these two is called the COP, and that can also be defined as refrigerating effect upon compressor work. So the basic components we can see here of a vapor compression refrigeration system. So I will explain to you what happens here. Since we have to take out heat from the substance which has to be cooled, so it basically takes place in the evaporator. What happens that the refrigerant, while which is at a lower temperature than the substance to be cooled, since it is having a high latent heat of vaporization, it will take away the heat from that substance and it will cool that particular substance. But since it is taken up heat, so what happens due to this latent heat, it will change into vapor. This vapor will be at a low pressure, and this will be further compressed in the compressor. Why it is being compressed? So that it can go into the cycle, and further at high pressure it can give away the heat to a certain body, since all this thing works on the laws of conservation of energy. Because if we are taking away heat from somebody, we have to give away that heat at a certain point. So it has to be compressed, and this vapor, when compressed, it comes at high pressure and high temperature, and then it further moves to the condenser. Condenser has certain some cooling effects is there by means of cooling water or any other thing which is coming. What will happen here also, heat exchange will take place, and the refrigerant will give away its heat to the particular cooling water or any other thing which is at a lower temperature than the refrigerant. So here when it has given away the heat to that cooling water, it will condense. Now from the vapor form it will come back to the liquid form, and when it comes back to the liquid form, then it moves to the expansion device. So expansion device, as soon as it expands, the pressure and the temperature will fall down and the refrigerant will come back to the evaporator. So in this way the heat is being extracted from the substance which has to be cooled, and it is thrown away at a certain point at higher temperature and pressure. So this whole cycle is thus constituted. Here also the cycle is shown, how the high pressure side is there and the low pressure side is there. On one end of the compressor, the high pressure and high temperature are there. On the other end, there is low pressure and low temperature. This is the pressure versus volume chart for the refrigeration cycle. And here we can see that from 1 to 2, the subcooled liquid is moving. Subcooling, what does that mean? Subcooling is actually when the refrigerant is moving from the condenser. It is being subcooled. What effect it gives? It gives more refrigerating effect. As you can see in the figure, that red line that is there, 4 to 1, if it can be extended, then the line which is coming 1 to 2, it will intersect with 2, 3 at a point which is towards the left side of the curve. So more amount of refrigerating effect can be produced if we subcool that particular refrigerant. And subcooling takes place before the expansion valve. From 2 to 3, this evaporation takes place. As you can see in the figure, blue line, 2 to 3 evaporation takes place, where the refrigerant evaporates and it takes away the heat from the particular substance. And from 3 to 4, what happens that it is being compressed, and generally what we want that the vapor, all the vapor should be there in the compressor, no liquid should reach because it can destroy the parts of the compressor. And then further it is superheated. Superheating also gives us more refrigerating effect. Then 4 to 1 we have got the condensing effect. So the whole cycle is there in the PV chart, and we can see how this practically works also. Here the 3D model of the compressor and all the things are there. Condenser is there, receiver is there, chiller is there, the tubes are there. So we can very easily see, and that expansion valve TXV, it is mentioned by TXV, it is also there. So whole cycle in practical terms is shown here. First of all, we have the refrigerant which is running in the blue and the red lines, as you can see in the figure. Then we have the evaporator or the chiller, where you can see the evaporator tubes. Then we have the compressor, which for which that figure is given, and condenser also we have got, and receiver. Everything is there in the 3D view, the practical view of the refrigeration cycle, thermostatic expansion valve as well. What does the evaporator or chiller do? As I have explained earlier also, more detailed things are given here. So it has to be located in a space to be refrigerated. Then cooling coil acts as an indirect heat exchanger. It absorbs heating from the surroundings and vaporizes, as I have told earlier also. So that is called latent heat of vaporization. And sensible heat is that when temperature will change, like from 50 degree to 100 degree, or like we have to go from 10 degree to 0 degree. So that is sensible heat, and latent heat is when phase changes. So it will be slightly superheated, so it ensures that no liquid carries over into the compressor because it can destroy the compressor parts. This is the diagram of the evaporator tubing. Then we come on to the compressor. Compressor, there is superheated vapor which enters as low pressure and low temperature vapor, and further when it is being compressed, then it exits as high pressure, high temperature vapor. So what happens due to this? There is a temperature differential which is created, and this will promote the heat transfer. Better heat exchange will be there. And then we have got the pressure effect also, that is allows for condensation at warmer temperatures, that is high pressure. And also increase in energy provides the driving force to circulate refrigerant through the system. That's why we have to circulate the refrigerant also, so that this thing provides the energy, compressor provides the energy for that. And we have got the condenser. What does condenser do? Refrigerant here rejects the latent heat. The latent heat, it has absorbed somewhere, it absorbed in the evaporator. Here it rejects it to the cooling medium. That's why this is according to the conservation laws of conservation of energy, because if we are taking something, we have to give also. Indirect heat exchangers are there, that is seawater, that is not of much use here. And then expansion device is there. This one is also very critical. That is thermostatic expansion valve TXV, and liquid freon or any other refrigerant enters the expansion valve at high pressure and leaves as a low pressure wet vapor, and vapor forms as refrigerant enters the saturation region. And what are the controls? It helps in pressure reduction and also in controlling the amount of refrigerant entering the evaporator. So indirectly it controls the capacity, as I told also, due to subcooling the capacity of the refrigeration system can increase. Air conditioning, what it is, purpose is to maintain the atmosphere of an enclosed space at a required temperature, and also to maintain the humidity and the purity. Refrigeration system is the heart of the AC system. So heaters also used in ventilation system, and types used are self-contained, refrigerant circulating, and chilled water circulating. So we can see here how the calculations for these take place. Generally in a cycle, what happens that the amount of heat taken up is also equal to the work done. And you can see in the figure that is sigma Q is equal to sigma W. So summation of all the heat is equal to summation of the work done. So in this way, I have defined earlier coefficient of performance. So coefficient of performance, we can say, see what was it? What was the definition of that? The definition was amount of heat extracted divided by the work done. So we can see here Q2 here represents the amount of heat extracted from the cold body, from the body which has to be cooled. And WC represents the compressor work. So COP of a refrigerator, what it will be? Q2 upon WC. Or we can represent it as WC is equal to Q1 minus Q2, because Q1 is the heat that is being taken up and Q2 is to be extracted. So Q1 minus Q2 will be the work done by the compressor. Further, we have also heat pump also. Heat pump, what happens that instead of heat extracted, what is the heat absorbed actually? So that's why the term Q1 comes here. Because Q1 is the heat absorbed, Q2 is the heat extracted. And the difference of the two is the work done. So we can see here COP, HP, the difference between the COP of a heat pump and the refrigerator is that Q1 terms comes in the numerator. Whereas in case of refrigerator, Q2 comes in the numerator. So what happens that due to this, COP of a heat pump is always 1 plus COP of the refrigerator. We can see here from 1 to 2 what is happening is that the from 1 to 2, this refrigerant is being compressed in the compressor. Here it in the figure it is not shown as superheated, but generally it is superheated. It is up to saturation level only. As you can see from 1 to 2, the temperature varies from TL to TH. This is for leading the refrigerant to a higher pressure and higher temperature. So we can see here what will be from 2 to 3, that will be the condensing effect, and from 3 to 4, this will be through the expansion valve. It will expand and come to a lower temperature and pressure. 4 to 1 is the refrigeration capacity, that is here the refrigerant is evaporating and it is taking away the heat from the body which has to be cooled. So the calculations are as such, like you can see Q2 is what, that is H1 minus H4, that means amount of heat extracted from the body, that is the refrigeration capacity, so it is Q2. And W we can see what is that, that is the work done by the compressor. So that can be represented by H2 minus H1. H3 is equal to H4 because this is an isenthalpic process, the enthalpy doesn't change here. So H3 is equal to H4. So when we calculate the COP, what happens? We have to again get the amount of heat extracted and it should be divided by the work done. So it comes down to what we can see here. Amount of heat extracted is H1 minus H4 and divided by H2 minus H1. So that can be put as what? H2 minus H3 minus H1 minus H4. So this is the COP expression if we go through the TS diagram of a simple refrigeration cycle. So now we have got...
I am interrupting you.
Yeah.
Mr. What is the subcooling in refrigeration?
Subcooling, I have told earlier also, if we go into the graph of this, we can see here from 2 to 3, this condensation takes place of the refrigerant. So
from this 2 to 3?
3, yes. Condensation takes place. But if we extend it further, if we have a point on that saturation line, you can see, I think, the left side line, you can see, then 3 to 3 dash, if we make a new point on that particular thing, then I can explain it on the board, I think. If you see, this is the simple refrigeration cycle, can be represented by this 1 to 2, 2 to 3 dash, and 3 dash to 4, and then back to 4 to 1. So here we can see there is no superheating of the vapor and there is no subcooling. But if we want to increase the capacity, that is refrigeration capacity, that is represented by this line 1 to 2. If we want to increase it, we can do two things. One is that we can superheat the vapor in the compressor. That will go from, now it will go from, not from 2, it will go from 2 dash, 2 dash to 3. So we can see this much amount of refrigeration capacity is increased. And similarly, subcooling, as my colleague asked, that for subcooling, what happens that after condensation of this refrigerant, if along the saturation line, if we move along that 4 to 4 dash before expansion, then what will happen? We can see here it will come down from 4 dash to 5 and instead of 4 to 1. So this much of refrigeration capacity will again increase. So subcooling is done generally for this increase of refrigeration capacity. Now we can define certain terms, that is refrigerating effect, that is equal to H1 minus H4, as I have explained on the board also, and the figure again I will show you, that is H1 minus H4 is the refrigerating effect. And the capacity will be given by multiplying by mass flow rate. So compressor power, if we see how much power will be required, is M dot into H2 minus H1, that will be given in kilowatts. So similarly, there is heat engine also. In case of heat engine, what we have, we get the work. we get the work, instead of putting the work to pump the heat from a colder body to a hotter body, we get the work in this case. So COP of this refrigerant, we have got exercise also for that. Like if I can put it on the board also. So suppose that it is,
how much will be the COP then?
Difference will come as what? Since we had that expression Q2 upon W, that can be Q2, what we have here will be represented by minus 13 degree centigrade. That can be also represented in terms of temperature if it is a reversible process, T2 by T1 minus T2. So T2 is what we can represent, since it is in degree centigrade, we can change to Kelvin. So it will be 260, since 273 minus 13 is 260, and then we have the difference of the two. So it will be 37 minus minus 13, that is 260 by 50, and we can get something 5 point something, it will come out. So this is the way we can calculate the COP. We can see how the compressor is given there, then through that at the other end of the compressor we have got a pressure gauge which measures the higher pressure, and then it moves to the condenser, and from the condenser there is the receiver also, and from the receiver it is going to expansion valve to further to the evaporator tubes, and so the whole cycle is running. This will be the lower side pressure, and from the what I explained earlier will be the higher side pressure. First of all, what is there, we can see is blue dots, it is represented at the bottom of the figure, that is absorber. And what happens here, I will tell you, in the absorber this particular refrigerant is being absorbed by another liquid, which may be water, like in case of water and ammonia system, we have got the absorber as water and refrigerant as ammonia. So here ammonia is being absorbed. What will happen, that this is an exothermic reaction, and due to the exothermic reaction heat will be given out, and due to this heat being given out, ammonia will tend to move out, so it will not be readily absorbed. So for that, what we have to do, so that ammonia is very well absorbed in water, what we have to do, we have to provide a cooling medium so that that exothermic reaction that is taking place is under control. And then from this, now we have got a strong solution of ammonia in water. From here, what will be done, that this strong solution will be pumped through a pump to the our generator. And before this, heat exchanger is also shown, I will explain further, but before let me tell you about the generator before that. So generator, in a generator what happens, this particular ammonia which was absorbed by water, here it is being separated higher temperature so that it can further go and condense. So here the separation takes place. How the separation takes place is that the generator, the heat is given. What will happen? It was coming out like an exothermic reaction. So both were being separated. So here we have to provide the heat so that refrigerant and the absorbent, they are separated here. So that when the refrigerant is extracted here, it will move further into the condenser, and there it will again give up its heat to another body, and it will further move down through the expansion valve at lower pressure and temperature to the evaporator. So the whole cycle runs, and you can see here that there is no compressor, no moving part. How the system is working, only on the basis of the heat exchange, absorber and the generator, and in between the two we can see what is there is a heat exchanger. For what purpose it is there? Since we are providing certain amount of cooling in the absorber, so we have to extract the heat. So that will be very helpful. It will reduce that amount of cooling. We can reduce. How we can reduce? By exchanging heat through the weak solution and the strong solution. So both weak and strong solution, they are exchanging heat with each other. And this is done to reduce the cooling effect near the absorber and to reduce the amount of heat that is taken up in the generator. So that work is done by this heat exchanger. So this is the whole absorption system. The COP, what is the COP of a vapor absorption refrigerator? We can see here it is represented by, that is QE by QG it is represented by. So that is TG minus T naught upon TG into TE minus TE divided by TO, or not minus TE. So I will tell you what these terms are. TG will represent the generator temperature, T0 will represent your surrounding temperature, and TE will represent your evaporator temperature. So we can see the difference between the generator and the surroundings, and divided by the generator temperature, multiplied by the evaporator temperature, and again divided by the difference between the surroundings and the evaporator will give us the COP of the vapor absorption refrigeration system.
That loopback signal is used to control the circuit within itself. Like say, if you are going to have, say, if you tomorrow change a device, or say if you have, say, change in the temperature, device characteristics are bound to change. But that should not hamper the operation of your transistor circuit. So you should have the biasing which will counter these kind of changes and bring back the operating point to the necessary preset value that we have designed our circuit for. The voltage divider or universal bias is shown in this particular circuit on the left hand side, and on the right hand side I have shown you the load line equations, that is what is your IC set. Now IC set in this particular case, the maximum current that is going to flow through the circuit is when VCE is equal to 0, that is VCC upon RC plus RE. So we have got this as the quiescent current that will be flowing, and you have base voltage VCC upon R2. I'm sorry, the quiescent of base voltage will be the potential divider arrangement at this particular point. The voltage at this point will be R2 upon R1 plus R2 into VCC. Then base voltage is this. Then since this terminal base to emitter is forward bias, emitter voltage will be, if in case of silicon transistor, the base the emitter voltage will be 0.7 volt less than the emitter voltage will be 0.7 volt less than base voltage. And IE will be decided by the beta factor or the gain of this particular transistor. We have here chain of resistors R1 and R2, because in this particular case we are going to provide this particular current through this circuit, where variation of any change in beta value is going to be negated. We always have, it will be independent of variation in the beta value. And secondly, this RE particularly here, emitter resistance, is going to compensate any change that is happening in IC or the collector current due to temperature change. Now this is happening in following way. Say there is some current flowing IC at particular some temperature. Now if the temperature increases, then IC also increases. As IC increases, the drop across this RE, that is the voltage appearing across this RE, also increases. The moment this voltage increases, the forward bias of this base emitter junction is reduced, and so effectively the current flowing through this transistor will reduce, because as you have already seen in our output characteristic, as our base current changes or VBE changes, we get